Hi guys, it is Tamara. Thank you so much for coming back to my channel. Welcome back. Today we're going to be talking about dissociation. Now there was a video that I did a couple days ago that really kind of triggered the topic of dissociation, and so I've gotten a lot of emails from you guys, a lot of tweets and a lot of DMs asking me to refocus my attention on dissociation, depersonalization, and derealization. So we will do that in this video. I think for today's video though, we're going to talk about dissociation, and then the next video we'll talk about depersonalization and derealization. Okay, I think there's a lot of people that struggle a little bit with a clear understanding of what dissociation is. So I'm going to define the general topic, and then I'm going to also talk about some specific categories that could be helpful for you to understand. Now, before I go into the video, let me just say my camera has been really wonky lately, so it's under construction. So hang in there, guys. If my volume is a little weird, I'm working on it. All right, let's go ahead and jump in. Thank you so much for coming back to my channel. For all of you who are subscribed and participating, thank you so much. And I welcome all my new subscribers. I welcome you to the channel. I think you're gonna like being here. Thank you for subscribing. And if you are new, I encourage you to hit that subscribe button. I think it's right over here, so that you can stick around with us and be a part of our community. And in case you don't know who I am, let me briefly introduce myself. My name is Tamara, and I'm an internationally and board certified trauma therapist, but I'm also licensed in mental health within my practice, and I specialize in treating children, teens, and adults, as well as families struggling with trauma. Let's go ahead and jump in. When we talk about the topic of dissociation, I want you to keep a few things in mind. Dissociation is a really complex topic, and there's a lot of people who run to Google, which is an unreliable platform to find adequate mental health information from. Here's why. When you're experiencing something, you're likely gonna go to Google. You can Google something as specific as, why am I detaching from reality? Or why am I numb? Google is gonna pull up a variety of search results. You're gonna get some websites, you're gonna get some forums, you're gonna get some support groups, you're gonna get some articles, and maybe even some videos. And in all of those resources, you may get false information, conflicting information, or you may get some truth with some, some dolled up version of dissociation because it draws people to the website or to the channel or whatever. It's a really unreliable way to understand dissociation. So my goal in this video is to make it explanatory, to make it very practical for you, and to also teach you about the subcategories underneath dissociation. Okay, so let's go ahead and start with dissociation. Let me go ahead and define that. So dissociation is basically a detachment from reality. It's a defense mechanism. It's a coping skill. It's a way that you have learned to protect yourself if you're one who experiences it. You know, you're going to get this general sense of numbness and this general sense of confusion and detachment from reality. You're really going to struggle with, you know, staying present in the moment. And after you have dissociated, you may actually find yourself feeling quite confused. You may feel like you've had an out-of-body experience, right? You may feel like you're watching yourself as a third person or second person. You may feel like you're watching a movie playing, or you're walking in a fantasy or some kind of life that's not your own. You may feel really odd in how, you know, you're really living out the present moment. And that is dissociation. It's like your mind has been warped by the trauma that you have gone through. And so your brain does some really interesting things neurologically and neurochemically to cause you to go through that particular experience. So we'll get into that some more, guys, as we go along. But dissociation is a real physiological and neurological process. It is real. It happens. And for a lot of people, there are stages. And I want you to think about these stages on a spectrum. So there's mild dissociation, there could be moderate dissociation, and there could be severe dissociation. There could be a combination of mild and moderate, right? Depending on where you are in your life or how far along or how, you know, regressed you are in your trauma healing. So dissociation is pretty complicated. It really is a detachment from reality. So this is reality. This is you. You're pulling away from reality as a result of not being able to tolerate the stress or the trauma that you have had to deal with. It's easier, it's safer to pull away from reality than it is to face the trauma head on. I've seen some clients really struggle with psychosis also when they are dissociating. They may begin to get really psychotic in terms of being delusional. They may hallucinate. Those are like really severe forms of dissociation. So dissociation is pretty complicated. So it really takes you know, a close eye to understand what's really going on. So let me go ahead and define some of the subcategories. I'm calling them subcategories to make this easier on you while you watch this video of dissociation. All right, so let's start with the first one. The first one is dissociative amnesia. Dissociative amnesia. This is basically an amnesia that is not physiological. It is not a form of amnesia that's the result of a physical injury, a brain trauma, right? Or a TBI, a traumatic brain injury. It's not the result of that. It's a result of psychological and emotional trauma. You may find yourself really forgetting the details of your life. You may find yourself really struggling with, you know, remembering your childhood, remembering certain details of a sexual assault, of a tragic incident, of a kidnapping, of an invasion, right? A home invasion, for example. You may really find yourself struggling with remembering specific details. You may also find yourself struggling to remember your childhood, your adolescence, or even what happened yesterday. Usually dissociative amnesia is so severe that medication is not going to necessarily help it. You have to go get psychotherapy, proper trauma treatment, and possibly work with a neurologist to figure out what it is that's going on in your brain and what's happening to you when you begin to feel triggered by something in your environment. You will also need a trauma therapist who is somebody who's very, very trained in traumatic brain injury, that's trained in the psychological effects of trauma, and somebody who can really get to the core of what's going on. Now, dissociative amnesia tends to be the result of severe childhood trauma, okay, or severe childhood abuse. So you can look at dissociative amnesia as not a physiological thing. It's more of a psychological and emotional thing that's triggered by unresolved or, you know, partially resolved trauma, right? Some people went through the trauma healing process and somehow, you know, they got derailed and they had to stop it. But, you know, depending on where you are in your trauma, really doesn't matter. The point of the matter is that dissociative amnesia is really the result of childhood trauma and a series of psychological and emotional events that led to stress or trauma. Dissociative amnesia. Okay. Now, there's another form of this, dissociative fugue. Okay, here it is right here, guys, because I know it's hard to really understand what it is. Dissociative fugue. The idea behind dissociative fugue is that you develop this sort of amnesia that causes you to forget who you are sometimes. It causes you to forget that you actually live in the home that you bought and designed yourself. You know, the house that you have been renting for 15 years, if dissociative fugue occurs, you may find yourself not remembering that that's where you live. You may walk into a home that is yours and look around and say, I don't recognize anything. I don't recognize those people on the photo albums over there. I don't recognize those people that I hung up on the wall. I don't recognize my bed. I don't recognize that my car is in my driveway. When did I ever buy this home? Who am I, right? And you may get to a point where you actually run away, for lack of a better word. You may actually leave that home to find a new life. Find a new existence, right? Because you don't know who you are and you don't connect with the things that are in your environment. You're a whole different person in your mind. And your previous history has nothing to do with who you are right now because you don't even know your previous history. You don't even connect the dots that your history is attached to you right now. So you almost create this new identity, okay? And this new lifestyle. And there has actually been stories about that where people have actually moved to California and they've gotten a new name, they've gotten a new appearance, they've gotten a new home, a new car, and they live a totally different life than what they lived before. It's not that they are intentionally trying to be different. They're different because of trauma, okay? Dissociative fugue. And basically, this can last, if I didn't mention already, weeks, days, months, even years. So it's really hard to tell. This is the enigma of psychotherapy and psychiatry. We don't know the extent to which these particular dissociative disorders can last and go, all right? Now, you know, there's a couple of things that I want you to keep in mind as well when we talk about dissociation. Dissociation is not just the simple fact of pulling away from reality and then kicking back to it and being okay. Dissociative disorders really do cause a disconnect between you, who you are as an individual, and your entire life. There's a major disconnection. And again, I want you to see dissociation on a spectrum, mild, moderate, severe. That makes it really easy. So if you're evaluating yourself as you're listening to this video or watching this video, you know, I want you to think about yourself on a spectrum. Where do I fit between mild, moderate, and severe in this scenario or in these particular examples that I'm providing? Okay, that may help you kind of be connected to the video and understand where you stand. Okay, there's three things that I want you to think about when you are really processing dissociation. One is that it's a detachment from reality. So you definitely need that in order to be diagnosed with dissociative disorders. There has to be a detachment from reality. Okay, the second thing is problems with memory and perception. Okay, so these things kind of have to be at the core of your issue before you receive a diagnosis. Okay, and the third thing that I personally look for, and I believe this is clinically researched as well, I'll try to put some information in the description box for you, but there's a third thing, and that's displaced sense of self, a displaced sense of self. There's a disconnection that causes significant distress, okay, because your sense of self is gone. There's no attachment to anything. It's gone. So you want to keep that in mind. There has to be a detachment from reality, a major problem with memory and perception, and a displacement of sense of self, okay? Those are the three things that you need to be diagnosed with dissociative disorders. Okay, guys, so depersonalization and derealization. We're going to do just a brief overview of what this is. So basically, derealization / depersonalization is the experience that there's a persistent feeling of a detachment from life as real. There's a persistent feeling, I'm trying to say, that there's a detachment from life as being real. Your surroundings are false. The objects around you are false. You're walking in a dream. You're walking in a fantasy. Life seems unreal to you, even though there may be a slight awareness in the back of your mind, in your subconsciousness, right? Or in your subconscious, I should say, that, okay, I'm in an altered state. So there's some awareness that what you're walking through is not necessarily normal or real, but you can't help but feel deep down that there's a sense of detachment from reality, that nothing around you seems real. You're walking in a movie. And you may also feel that you are kind of looking down upon yourself experiencing life. There may be that much of a detachment. Derealization and depersonalization is rather rare, but when it does happen, it's pretty severe. And individuals can actually, begin to experience panic attacks. They can begin to have severe depression. They can become suicidal because, you know, life isn't real to them. They feel like they're watching themselves in a movie. They're not really focusing on the fact that this is your life. You know, it's not like dissociative fugue, okay, where, you know, there's this amnesia about who you are. It's more so, I know who I am, but I just feel like my every waking moment of my life is false. There's nothing real about it, right? And there's this dreamlike mentality and state that you walk in, you exist in, you operate in, and it's really hard to shake that. Think of when you wake up in the morning, let's say you wake up by your alarm clock scaring you to death, or you wake up because somebody's coming in your house and you weren't expecting it. You're going to jump up in a panic. Your heart is probably racing. You're probably a little bit confused. You're foggy. That's kind of how derealization and depersonalization is. It's like you're waking up out of a deep sleep trying to focus and function in your world, and it feels like you're in this foggy dream state, like you're just waking up. That's the best way that I can explain derealization and depersonalization. It's a huge, huge issue for those who do experience it. Again, it's rare, but when it does happen, it's pretty severe and pretty life-altering. The individual's daily functioning is impacted by this. Daily functioning, including work, home life, community involvement, it really impacts the individual's life, okay? These are all trauma symptoms, guys. And, you know, this is something that you're probably used to hearing about, but to get the appropriate information is really hard, especially on YouTube and in Google sometimes. So I hope that this clarified dissociation, depersonalization, and derealization. Now, there's one more thing that I want to mention before we wrap up, and that is dissociative identity disorders. I talk about them right up here in this video, and it was a series that I did, I think a year or two ago, And dissociative identity disorder is part of the dissociative disorders, and you can kind of categorize this as a multiple personality disorder. Okay, that's what it used to be called. You don't want to call it that today because there's a lot of political correctness about that term. So, multiple personality disorder is what it previously was referred to. It has been updated a few years ago as dissociative identity disorder. And what happens here is that there is a severe detachment from reality, to a point of experiencing fragmented pieces of your existence. Okay, there's different pieces of you. And you may be vastly different from the other fragmented pieces of who you are. So you may be a different gender. So there's a fragmented piece of yourself that's a different gender, a different race. You have different hair color, different dress, different voice sometimes, you know, different personality completely sometimes, different, different interests in food and music and art, and the list goes on. Like the fragmented pieces of somebody with dissociative identity disorder can be really severe. Remember that spectrum, mild, moderate, severe. So if we're talking about severe did dissociative identity disorder, then we're talking about an individual who's so fragmented that they don't realize they're different pieces of themselves. And it's so different that you may find a really, what's the word I'm looking for, guys? Emotionally destabilizing to know that, oh my God, I cut my hair because I was in Susie's role yesterday. I cut my hair, or because I was in Tom's role, I wore these jeans, And, it's like living with various personalities within yourself. Dissociative identity disorder is pretty complex. And, I'm going to go so far as to say there's not enough research and information on it on the web that's legitimate, reliable, and correct. And so we need a lot of research to try to understand that particular disorder. But it is categorized underneath the heading of dissociation, dissociative disorders. Okay? And there's a couple of others, but I won't make this video too long. Stick around, guys, because I'm going to be breaking down the different types of dissociative amnesia in the coming days. Thank you so much for being with me today, guys, in this video. I encourage you to give it a thumbs up and go ahead and hit that subscribe button so you can stick around with us and be a part of our channel. And hit that bell button so that you can get updates on when I post videos, because sometimes I give you bonuses throughout the week and you won't know if you don't hit that bell button. So if you want to know when I post, go ahead and hit that bell button. I'll see you in the next video. Bye.